Hello, I'm Jack Rickard. This is EVTV. More news. Tesla got hacked last Saturday. Not their car, not my car, but their website and Elon Musk's Twitter account. The group sort of posed as two things. Let's see, one of them was called Ripper Shack. One of them was, let's see here. Ripper Gang and Autism Squad. The Tesla Motors website went down and was replaced with kind of a hideous mock-up on there. And a number of Twitters were released, purportedly by Tesla and Elon Musk, that offered a free Tesla Model S to anyone that would call a telephone number. They gave the telephone number of a Paul and Blair Strader outside of Chicago, and they got calls around the clock for several days, some from as far away as South Africa, seeking a Model S. One guy even showed up at their house wanting to look in their garage and make sure they didn't have one in there for him. The story is kind of bizarre, but it illustrates that media's sense of hacking and ours is quite different. A hack is actually a elegant computer algorithm. Or a elegant way of disassembling and decoding one. It has come to mean breaking into computers by juvenile delinquents. And that's usually not only not very elegant, although sometimes clever, but has little to do with computers, and that was pretty much the case here. The Straders have a son who's given to hacking. Now he portrays himself as a white hat hacker that breaks into computer systems to point up security holes. But he has come crossways with a guy named Kivimaki in Finland. And this guy has had flowers delivered to their home, pizzas, had their cable cut off, their power cut off, and the police called coming to investigate the death of Amy Slater. And so just general harassment. What he did in this case was somewhat clever, although it's bizarre that AT&T would go along with this. He called American Telephone and Telegraph and told them to reroute all, told them he was with Tesla, and to reroute all telephone calls to Tesla to another number, a new number. The number was his. And then he used that to contact Network Solutions and get an additional email access to Network Solutions as the domain registrar. That's how you maintain your C records and so forth, where your domain name points to as far as a computer with an IP number. And once he had access to Tesla's domain registration, he redirected all TeslaMotors.com to his computer where he had this thing. Apparently also broke into Twitter using kind of the same ruse and got to be Elon Musk and Tesla Motors for a day. And so that's how all the telephone calls to the Slaters in Chicago. Paul Slater says he didn't know, he thought Elon Musk was some sort of men's fragrance. But he's been taking a lot of telephone calls these days. And the FBI has been called in. They really can't do anything about it because the guy's not on U.S. soil. I think Tesla is more wanting some splaining to be done by American Telephone and Telegraph. And so that's the Tesla hack of the moment. Segway founder Dean Kamen. Remember the Segway? It's an upright balancing two-wheeler electric. We had one. I kind of liked it, but I was a little afraid of it. Dean, as he often does, makes millions and then goes broke a lot, and then makes more millions and then goes broke a lot. A really interesting guy, interesting mind. And the Segway was a fascinating invention. It did go broke and was sold to their largest British distributor. The guy that ran that absolutely loved the device and was out riding it one morning, not 6 months after purchasing the company, and ran into a young lady and her dog. And somehow he went over a cliff in the Segway and was killed while riding the Segway. The interesting thing now is that Dean Kamen had once accused a Chinese robotics company, Ninebot, of patent infringement. They basically ripped off the Segway and had a two-wheel device that was self-balancing, very much like it. Ninebot has now acquired the remnants of Segway. They bought the company. And Ninebot has $80 million in funding now from Xiaomi, Sequoia Capital, and Shenwei Capital. And they bought the thing for an undisclosed amount. If you recall, I sort of panned an electric bike that was about $500, talking about May deliveries and in February on a Kickstarter campaign. I found this kind of interesting that they're now being sued by their public relations firm. The company's called Storm Saunders, and they didn't pay their PR agency. But apparently, they did collect $5.3 million in contributions. Now, the contributions are kind of funny. You make them, they don't really get them until they deliver things. Their beach cruiser was supposed to be $649, so it's kind of up in the air what's going to happen. They couldn't pay their PR agency and are being sued there. There's a report called Crowdfunder Insider Reports, and they note that 43% of Kickstarter campaigns are successful. Indiegogo's success rate is a dismal 9.8%. And so that's kind of what's going on. We're still waiting to see if the e-bike actually occurs. The Central Japan Railway Company has a maglev train that they're spending $85 billion on called the Chuo Shinkansen. And this is going to connect Tokyo with Osaka eventually, but they have a test track near Mount Fuji. And they just did a run at 603 kilometers per hour. That's a new world record, 366 miles per hour, and now 373 with the latest, 373 miles per hour, 603 kilometers per hour. That was for a 10-second spurt, but it uses electromagnets to kind of levitate the train 4 inches off a metal track and allows it to go very smoothly. They are interestingly proposing to connect Washington, D.C. to New York City, and they want to set up a thing from Baltimore to Washington, D.C., 40 miles, as a showcase to America with the events in Baltimore. That might be very interesting. Wonder what police force would be patrolling that connection from Baltimore to Washington, D.C. Oh, that's about what I've got this week. Nissan makes much ado about going over 177,000 electric vehicles. They have now sold more than the Chevy Volt worldwide and can justifiably claim to be the most numerous OEM electric car on the market. We received a viewer video that I was quite enamored of. It's a young man named Jose Barriga in Tampa, Florida. Jose is a software programmer, kind of limited means, very young, and so he represents the how to do a thrifty, bare bones conversion without being what I term a bottom feeder. He used quality components and did it as best he could. He was somewhat empowered by our offering the Better Place packs of essentially Nissan Leaf cells a year ago at $3,600 for a 24 kilowatt pack. He made pretty good use of them with a Nissan Sentra with a total investment of $17,000. He's driving in style. Let's take a look at this.
Hello, my name is Jose Barriga from Florida, and in this video I want to show you a summary of the features of my Nissan Sentra 2004 SER Spec B converted to electric. I recorded the conversion, and this is video number 40. Since I consider the car completed, I think it's right time to make a summary of the conversion. You can see the rest of the videos at tampaelectriccar.com. I want to thank my wife, Lady, for recording the videos. As of today, I have almost 400,000 views of my YouTube channel. I have more than 1,200 subscribers and almost more than 100,000 likes. So I want to thank all the followers of this project. I know I have already inspired several conversions, which is very exciting. So let's start with the conversion, with the summary. Like with many other conversions, I started by removing the electric, the gasoline component, like the motor, muffler, gas tank. And since I converted it, it's my daily commuter. So I've been driving this for about 3.5 years. It gives me about 70 miles per charge. It can go at 90 miles per hour easily. It does 0 to 60 miles per hour in 12 seconds. And it takes about 7 hours to charge completely when it's fully discharged. I have several stickers identifying the car as an electric car. This is one, this is another, this is another, my stickers. And this is a sticker that I could remove as I need if I want some attention or not. I can tell, for example, when the stickers are on, I can see a few fingerprints in the window. And when I have the stickers on, I have some thumbs up when I'm driving, so I remove them or leave them on if I want some attention or not. In the back, I have some stickers also that make identify the car as an electric vehicle, and my license plate, of course. So let's start the tour in the trunk. This car was born electric with 26 volt lead acid batteries, and that didn't work very well for me. They weighed 1400 pounds and they died really fast, and they need constant maintenance. So I upgraded to 24 kilowatts of lithium batteries that I bought at EVTV from Jack Rickard and Brian Nodal. These batteries came from Israel, from the company Better Place, and were originally used in a Renault Fluence. They fit very well in the car, and I use these covers to increase my trunk space, and I put a double cover on top of the batteries to support more weight. I have the batteries connected, 3 in parallel and 16 in series, for a total of 48 batteries. This is a 120 volts nominal system. These batteries are bottom balance, and I don't use a BMS or battery management system. I consider that I don't need one, because since I bottom balance them, they have not lost more than 0.02 volts between them. That's remarkable. I don't think I've ever need a BMS. Now, I want to show you how well they fit in the trunk. I even got a little bit of space between the on the sides for storage. These are the same cells that Nissan Leaf uses. Now, I decided to sell the batteries deep down in the trunk so I'd be able to use some space. Now, under, I covered the supports with black PVC, making them water and dust proof. As you can see, there's enough space under the car to clear any obstacle. Also, as a precaution, I install a little small smoke detector on the top, just in case. Now, sometimes the place where I need to go is just a few miles from a charging station. And since I install so much metal under the batteries, I start to install a trailer hitch to increase the functionality of my electric car. One of the things I use with this, for example, is a bicycle rack. And also to drag a trailer that I'll show later. I figure if the car was good enough to drag 1400 pounds of lead acid battery, it would be good enough to drag a few pounds in a trailer. Okay, next I'm going to show you my battery charger and my charging port. Like with many conversions, I use my gas store and my gas compartment for the J1772 port for level 2 charging. And I stick at my original NEMA conversion for the time that I use a cheap cable to connect to a regular 110 volts. I can use a cheap cable to connect here. The way I select which connector I want to use is with this switch. So the non-selected connector does not have live lines. My charger is an Elcom PFC 2500 and it's installed under the car. I started outside for better ventilation and I put some covers to protect it from the water and then the dust. It charges at 110 or 240 volts and it provides 2500 watts of power. I get about 7 or 8 miles of range for every hour that I charge. Now that charger has a LED that indicates the errors or the state of charge, and since it's really difficult to read down there, I install a fiber optic that comes all the way through here so I can read that status of charge or error from the charger. Now, let's take a look under the hood. As I said, I removed the gasoline converter components and I installed some covers to protect from dust and reduce the noise from the road. And as you can see, I have a frunk now. I have so much space left that I have a frunk like the Tesla Model S. You have to see the faces people make when they when I intentionally put groceries under the hood. Let me remove the covers so you can see the components. I usually remove these covers when I go to car shows. My plan is to install in this space another set of batteries to double my range. The motor I use is a net gain, impulse 9, double shafted, and even though it's not strictly required, I have a small blower to cool off the motor and blow the dust from the brushes. I'm also using a solid one controller that can handle up to 1000 amps. I have a small cooling system from the to the controller that it starts automatically, but I can start it with this switch. The adapter place is welded iron. It's not pretty like the ones made of aluminum, but it does the job. It works remarkably well. The power steering electric pump is here on this side. And on this side, these capacitors are the replacement of my accessories batteries. Capacitors last forever and it's one less thing to maintain,
compared to a battery. Since there's no cranking or starter anymore, these capacitors are just used for absorbing the current peaks. Next to that is my DC to DC converter. This will charge the capacitors and will convert volts from 120 to 12 volts. This pretty much replaced the alternator in a gasoline car. Now, in order to have power brakes, I installed this electric vacuum pump, and this is my additional vacuum reservoir. This is my vacuum sensor, and this will alert me if I lose the vacuum. This here is my emergency disconnect that I can pull from inside of the car in case of emergencies. The system fuse is here. The shunt for the amp meter is here. And this is my inertia switch in case of accidents, it will disconnect the system. Finally, the compressor of the air conditioning and the controller are here behind the fender. This is a King Leo electric compressor, and the condenser is installed here outside of the engine compartment to give me more space inside. As I said, I plan to install a second set of batteries for Nissan Leaf eventually. Now, here in the front, since there's not a huge radiator now to cool off, I decided to cover these vents, and I installed a Chevy Bolt air dam in the lower part. These things, and I just left a little space here for air, for the condenser. And it's amazing, by just doing this, I gained about 10 to 15% of efficiency, especially highway. I also replaced the lights with head xenon lamps and the running lights with LED. Let me show you, hopefully you can see the LED bulbs. Now, in this part, I installed some LEDs to make it noticeable when the car is running, because electric cars are so quiet that I may leave it on unintentionally. Now, let's take a tour inside the car. In the car, I kept the original pedal using the car computer. I figure if it was good enough for the car computer, it's good enough for my controller, and so far so good. Now, here's where I keep my network cable to configure the controller. And this is my heater. This thing's over $10, and it's amazing how much heat this can generate. It goes here. I'd say these things are good for up to 40 degrees Fahrenheit, and for here in Florida, it's pretty much enough. Now, on the air conditioning controls, I kept the original AC controls. This is not mechanic anymore. This is connected to a potentiometer, connected to the AC controller. And this switch is also connected to the controller. This just basically tells the controller to make the compressor work faster or slower. This is my emergency disconnect as well. As I said, I can just pull it up to disconnect the system in case of emergencies. This is my JLD404 that I use to measure ampere hours, time connected, amperes, and voltage. This is amazing how well it fits in the ashtray, in an old ashtray space. It looks like it was made for this. Now, the dashboard, the original indicators are working pretty much. And for the most part, they're working fine. This is the power steering, and it has a positional sensor and a timer, so it will disconnect the power steering when the car is going straight. Let me show you. And when I'm going straight, it just disconnects the power. Now, this is my vacuum meter gauge that will beep when I lose the vacuum when the vacuum goes below a programmable value, let me show you how it works by exhausting the vacuum in the brakes. My programmer is. This alarm is very valuable to me since there's no way to brake with the engine anymore. Direct voltage systems like this one do not have regenerative braking. And if something fails, like for example the fuse for the vacuum pump burns, I want to know right away if something's wrong. Here top is pretty much flat, but if in a place with a lot of hills, I think that's a must. Now let me show you the trailer that I use for the electric car functionality. And I'll show you later a video when I picked up my lawnmower in this trailer. Basically I use this trailer for driving stuff in my electric car. I think it's time to go for a drive. Come with me. Okay, here we go. I must say that I love to drive this car. I'm really happy with the conversion and drives really well. It has the feeling of a much more expensive car because it's very quiet and it doesn't vibrate, especially like four-cylinder cars. In this conversion, I decided to keep the clutch so I can change shift easily, even though because of the great torque of electric motors, I drive it third shift all the time. I don't really need to idle in red lights, so I can just leave the speed on. It drives like an automatic. I just don't need to change gears much more often, except like when I go to the highway. I start in third shift. For example, it's in third shift right now, and it's just starting. Without being a race car, it has excellent performance. It needs very little maintenance. And it was very satisfactory to build, to drive a car that I worked myself. I must say that I did everything in this car except for a little help I needed in the adapter plate and in the hoses for the AC, which you need a high pressure equipment for those. The indicators in the dashboard, they all work very well. I want to show it. I originally have my indicators here in the pillar, and they were an analog meter and volt meter, and the problem was that they were blocking my view here, and I removed them when I installed my JLD 404, which is now really accurate and very good way to know my state of charge. Now I'm going to show you power steering. When the power steering is going straight, after a few seconds it just turns off. And when I turn, it'll turn on automatically with the positional sensor and a timer. And since there's not much weight on the front anymore, I don't really need to use the power steering that much. I can just drive with the power steering off most of the time. I just use it mostly when I park. My current projects are to install an electric power steering, and I'm using also Arduino boards to try to fix the original gasoline indicator and the temperature indicator. And I'm also trying to fix the cruise control with an Arduino board. The other project is to get another set of Nissan Leaf batteries and put them on the front to increase my range. And I think that's it. Thanks for watching. My name again is Jose Barriga. This is a summary of my electric car, and you can see the rest of the videos at tampaelectriccar.com. And happy to drive this car. Very excellent experience driving this car. Excellent performance. And thank you for watching. Bye.
This is an example of what I was telling you earlier about the trailer. I built a trailer hitch for my electric car, and then I can use it to drag around things. I just bought this thing, so as you can see, it can drag weights and increase the use the functionality of my electric car by a lot by being able to pull things out. It works great even pulling things out. I'm gonna show you.
The young man is clearly passionate about electric vehicles, is really quite sincere, is building a following with his videos and threatening to displace Yehu Garcia as the shortest video EV guy in captivity. And I was quite taken with his obvious pride in a very nice build done on a budget. And that represents kind of a mark there, and I think he did a good job. And so, way to go, Jose Barriga. We hope it's the first of many. Speaking of many, Damien McGuire, Wexford County Cork, Ireland, and our Chatimo hero, who has just done, at this point, hundreds of runs to Chatimo stations. Colin, I can again mangle the software and remangle it again, did do some work on his Panzer this week, and it's kind of an interesting area. Let's take a look.
All right, folks, welcome back to the Panzer. So, as some of you will have seen from the previous videos, we've been working on the motor controller. But the weather has been so fine lately that I decided it's time to get out to the actual car and to do some of the mechanical work. So, as we discussed in previous videos, the E31 uses hydraulics not only for the power steering, but also for power brakes through the use of a hydroboost system. And so it's quite an important part of our conversion process that we devise ourselves a system that can provide sufficient pressure and quantity of hydraulic fluid to these systems. So in order to do that, some months ago I purchased this particular pump. This pump came from a 2004 Opel Zafira 7-seater people carrier, and like a lot of these electro-hydraulic power steering pumps that we see on cars now, it is actually powered by its own three-phase AC motor and a dedicated controller. This pump is very popular with the drift car scene and modified car scene, and also in some of the custom builds where people are looking to fit electro-hydraulic power steering systems. Now, in our previous conversions, we used a kind of ubiquitous Toyota MR2 power steering pump, and it works quite well in the E36 compact, but it is somewhat underperforming in the larger E39. So before I was to go ahead and, you know, start making brackets and installing this pump permanently, what I decided to do was to plumb the pump in and just literally hold it in with a few bungees. And we're now going to fill it, and we're going to just run it from that red 12-volt lead-acid battery. And we're going to see if we start getting power assist on our steering and on our brakes. Now, over here on the kind of hydraulic distribution block, there is this electrical connection. And this is a pressure sensor that illuminates a light on the dash of the car that basically tells us if we have sufficient hydraulic pressure in here to run the brakes in particular. So I'm not honestly certain what's going to happen here, but we're going to basically try this out and see if the pump can make sufficient pressure for us. I'm hoping it will, on the grounds that it does have a pressure sensor and it throttles up and down to maintain a particular pressure set point. I've also got a hydraulic pressure gauge that goes up to about 1600 psi on the high pressure port of the pump, so we'll be able to see exactly what's going on from a pressure perspective. And I'm just using standard hydraulic fittings to bring just a hydraulic flexible hose to bring the hydraulic fluid under pressure into the distribution block. The fitting into the block is a 16 millimeter, so we just got a 16 millimeter 2/3 BSP fitting in there with a copper washer. So I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to put some fluid into the system here, and we will start running it and see what actually happens. And you guys are going to be along with me for the full story here, and hopefully we won't get too many leaks. So I'm going to start off by putting some fluid into the actual reservoir on the pump. Now, we will be using the main reservoir here, and when the pump is installed properly, it's going to be installed down there, so we'll be sealing off the filler lid here. But just for the purposes of actually priming off the pump, we'll just go straight in. Now, the fluid I'm using is what's recommended by BMW. It's a CHF, or central hydraulic fluid, and it's green. So which is also good, because there was some traces of the original fluid in this pump, and that was indeed green as well. So a bit of luck. We shouldn't have any compatibility issues here. So this does seem significantly lighter than normal ATF, which would be usually implied in these type of systems. So the pump is actually connected to the 12 volt battery there, and there's a kind of a signal wire that is used to start it, which is very handy for us when we actually get the the system set up properly, assuming this pump actually works for us. It's ran away there for a second. I just want to let's actually take out this little filter. It's kind of slowing down the filling on me here a little bit more than I would quite like. I'm sure I'm going to get a little bit of that fluid somewhere, no matter what I try to do. I'm going to give this a good fill up, and we start the pump. Obviously the fluid's going to start circulating, and we'll have to kind of see what happens. So let's give this some spin. Be able to just clip it onto that. Start running out of fluid. Oh yeah. Oh, I've got pressure. I'm getting hydraulic pressure here, guys. Oh yeah, 400 psi of pressure. Oh. Pump's got a little prime on it. Yeah, there we go. Glad I had my Hopefully we'll get circulating here. A little bit of pressure. I wonder, are we actually circulating? I think we are, yeah. I actually think the pump's running here, guys. I think our system is kind of bled out. So I've got, actually got pressure here. All right. We're now down to, we're running at about, I guess maybe 20 or 30 pounds per square inch. I'm going to shut you guys down and bring you in and let you see the pressure gauge while I move the wheel around. Alright guys, we're running. The low pressure here. So, we're actually getting fluid circulation going on here. First thing I'm going to do is try and turn the wheel in the car. Here goes. Oh yeah. Oh, I've got power steering here. And coming back. Oh yeah. Got a good brake pedal there as well. You guys have been seeing the pressure anyway. I just get my fluke ammeter here, which I happen to have handy. See how much juice we're drawing. And our DC line drawing 16.4 amps right now. So I'm going to top up the fluid a little bit there. It's a little low. We're probably letting air out of the system when I'm doing the steering as well. It's 2 liters of this stuff in there now. I'm going to turn on the key and see if our light for our brakes has gone out. Yeah. I think my crappy 12 volt battery is probably crapping out. But it looks like this is a goer, folks. Okay guys, so we're on the fluke meter. I just go for one more shot. Amps. I'm going to hit the brakes first of all. You hear the accumulator charge after it exhausts. Here's the brakes. As the accumulator charging valve gets open. And again. As you turn the wheel. Power steering feels absolutely factory. It's absolutely brilliant. I'm also pleased to report that it's obvious that our accumulator is still working, because we get about three or four pumps of the pedal before the pump has to repressurize the hydraulic accumulator. So that's all good. Let's disconnect and we'll wrap this up. Well, there you have it folks, power steering and power brakes for the Panzer in one easy step. I know that it's going to mean now that I'm going to have to drain this all down and properly install the pump, but I think it was a worthwhile exercise, because had I actually found that the pump couldn't run the systems or just couldn't deliver enough fluid flow to to turn the wheel. I was basically turning the steering wheel just with the flat of my hand in there from lock to lock. There's 245s on the front of this car and it's pretty much sitting here completely stopped. So I'm very happy that pump can actually supply sufficient flow and pressure to run our power steering setup. And perhaps more importantly, it can supply enough flow and pressure to run the power brakes also. You could probably see, particularly when we were looking at the pressure gauge, that as I would pump the brake pedal, the pump wouldn't have to do anything, but then all of a sudden the pressure gauge would just go up. And you'd hear the pump load up and then there'd be a click and it'd just drop the pressure back down. That's because underneath the left side headlight here is a nitrogen filled accumulator that basically stores the hydraulic fluid under pressure to run the power brakes. That is done so that in the event of a sudden engine failure, that you can safely coast the car off the road and still have power assist for three or four complete presses of the brake pedal. So I'm very pleased that that's actually working, because God only knows in this country where I would get an accumulator like that, or get it serviced or reconditioned. So very pleased with that, pleased that our pump works. We had a couple of leaks there. I've got a couple of drip trays under the car just to catch all that. But very pleased with this. So the next phase of this operation really is to get that pump properly installed and get all the plumbing sorted out on it. Alrighty folks, we have our pump installed, got some new pipe work in here as well, so I think we're good to fill up with some fresh CHF and see if it runs as well. And it's installed this way, as it did when we had it kind of bungeed in, so fingers crossed. Oops. Okay. I reckon we'll probably drain that tank pretty quickly when we start off. So here goes. Pump's running. No leaks so far. Let's do some brake pumping and steering wheel turning. Try the brakes first. Perfect. Check our fluid level. That's looking great, guys. Gonna tie up that high pressure hose, but apart from that, I think we're good. Guys, that power steering is running absolutely perfectly. It's absolutely free. I've got no problems whatsoever turning the wheel just with the flat of my palm. So, gotta tie up this line. And I think we're all set here.
This comes up a lot. I really don't like the vacuum pumps that people resort to for brakes. mostly because they're loud. On the Escalade, we have a hydraulic pump that runs off the auxiliary shaft of the motor. And it's quite quiet and quite powerful, and it runs both the brakes and the steering, so we have power brakes and power steering. Damien is showing you how to adopt any electrically driven power steering pump for brake and steering duty, producing a fairly quiet, reliable pump that will give you power assist on your brakes and your steering. And I thought it was illustrative. It's a common problem we have, people that phone in with a lot of questions. I suppose I should do a build with one of those and find the ultimate car electric pump and then carry it, but so far we haven't. So that's Damien McGuire. Let's take a look at what I've been doing in the shop and why we're not making any headway with cars these days. I know a lot of you are wishing we'd get back to building cars, and I kind of miss them too. I am kind of driving around on some beautiful spring days in the yellow VW thing, and it's but even it's falling somewhat behind. I want to get an EVIC Andromeda Interfaces EVIC display in it, hooked up to the JevQ, and a JLD 505, to where I've got all that coolness on the dashboard about our JevQ and our Siemens system. And of course, we need to complete the UQM version with the green VW thing that has the UQM Power Phase 100 and also a CHAdeMO port. And that's kind of what's delayed that while we stopped and played JLD 505. I've included in this episode a very basic, inexpensive $17,000 build by Jose Barriga of Tampa, a young software programmer who's got a young family and needs to watch his Ducats prudently, not in a dumpster diving cheaper is ever better sense, but he's made some excellent prudent choices and has a good car. We've been here at the bench for several weeks playing with decoding CAN bus things and repairing stuff. Since last we were here, Mark found 25 of the wake on charge modules for the Azure Dynamics eTransit Connect. And I've talked to a couple of Ford dealers who actually have these still out there, brand new. Most of them 300 or more days on the market without a nibble. And down in the high 20s, and I'm talking to one about maybe a further reduction, because they can't sell them because nobody can repair them, including Ford. Back to our previous episode. Anyway, this is the Axiomatic module, and Mark found a guy in the UK who has nothing to do with electric cars, it's just an electronics liquidator, who had them and didn't really know what they were for. And had 25 of them. We bought them all. We'll have them in the store. I don't know. You know, it's not. It's kind of an interesting little unit. It works off of the, it kind of replaces Dave Kurzel's AVC2 and will wake up your JevQ or whatever, send out a 12-volt signal when it gets the signal from the J1772 system. And so, but I don't see it being a big seller except to Ford dealers and people with Azure Dynamics. But we'll have plenty on hand to fix mine, and that one's going to go in it. We had a little card table here, literally covered with cardboard, and it just got to be a mess. So I thought we would put one of our nice maple benches in. It was beautiful. I should have filmed it. When I transferred all the stuff over to this, it looks about like the card table. But the card table is literally bowing in too. So I made a more permanent bench here, and it'll be a test bench where I can test the little controllers we build and perhaps the occasional variant on these devices. This here is the Chevy Volt auxiliary, or accessory power module, APM. Their version of a DC to DC converter does 165 amps. You can adjust the output voltage, and it's air-cooled. This is the Ebbespasha that Mark and I have been working on, and I'm playing around Byron Eisenbard had given me the part numbers, so we're getting the actual connectors for the thing. And that's what we do, is a basic little controller that's simply an enclosure with a USB port on it. And then we have to do a little harness for each device. They all have different plugs. We have one plug for that. We'll have two plugs for the Ebbespasha. We have this plug for the Chevy Volt charger, which I'm growing more and more fond of. And then there's our Delphi DC to DC converter. And of course, three of these have to be water cooled. And so I've got a cart here with a couple of heat exchangers, a fill bottle, and a pump. And so that's what we're doing there. And so I thought I'd set up a bench. The whole central issue, you know, I've looked at it. They are available on eBay. I'm sure some of you will probably buy them from there. I think EVTV, probably for our purposes, will buy them like the chargers new from the dealers. We have gotten some of the salvage ones. They chop off cables unpredictably. They send us the wrong part a lot of times. It's just kind of a mess right now. eBay is your best place. The actual salvage places online are very difficult to deal with because they don't really know anything about these parts. They don't even know, they don't even have them labeled as the right parts. It's sort of order whatever you like and use whatever they send you. And we've had some mixed success with them. I've done best, and we've sold 12 or 14 of these Chevy Volt chargers already. They like them. I like them. So we're just getting where we're getting those from the manufacturer, from the GM parts outlets, brand new. And that leaves us to procure some connectors and some pins and make a little controller. We've been using the Kandui kit, really, that we have on the website. It consists of an Arduino Due board and the Kandui. I have to add a somewhat expensive little weatherproof port here for USB, and then a little cable to actually hook it up to the board inside. There's some things I don't like about the Arduino Due, and we're taking a look at that. The biggest one is it uses a very tiny micro USB port that is just barely held onto the board. So any kind of stress on that port, and it comes loose from the board, and of course at that point becomes non-functional. I've been working with Paulo. As you know, we got 20 JLD-505s that had all sorts of things wrong with them. So I've gone out to five different Chinese PC board places and ordered five boards apiece from each of them. And the ones that actually make them where they work, we'll order a couple hundred more of these. This is, I call it the EVTV Arduino, or Due. EVTV Due. It is, in all respects an Arduino Due clone with a couple of changes. And the biggest one is we've removed the programming port. The Arduino Due has two ports, a programming port with its own USB chip that is then hooked into a serial port on the ATSAM, Atmel SAM 3X multi-controller. The other port we call the native port, there is a USB port built into the SAM 3X. And it's very fast. It doesn't have some of the features of the other port, but we can kind of work around that. And it's that's called the native port in Arduino speak. And we've replaced it with the micro B or the mini B port that was originally intended for printers. I like this big square port because it's strong and it has two big pins that we solder to the board, and so it's very difficult to dislodge it from the board. Where the second port was, we've put this four-pin screw terminal. And that lets us bring in 12 volts. In almost all these devices, they require 12 volts. And if you don't use the laptop to power it through the USB port, which you won't most of the time, we have to be able to get 12 volts to the board. The little barrel jack thing is something that can come loose and does. And so we kind of hardwire to one of these strip terminals. The other two terminals are actually a CAN port. It's always CAN zero. There's only one of them. Most of the time with a CAN Due, I only use one port. And I always use the one with the screw terminals. I almost never use the one with the OBD2 connector. And so this has that CAN port and screw terminals right on the board. The other thing the Arduino didn't have was an EEPROM chip. And we have added a 256 kilobyte EEPROM chip, which is ridiculously more than we need, but they're $2. They're cheap. And so we've added that. Unfortunately, on the first five that we got from one Chinese company, everything works except the EEPROM. And so there are some ways to use the flash memory as persistent memory, and I'm experimenting with that. But hopefully the other boards will come in with the EEPROM working. The CAN works fine, the USB works fine, and the board works fine. Loads and runs programs, it's excellent. This will let us get down to a single board in our controller. And we won't need the Arduino Due plus the CAN Due, except on the Eberspacher heater. Because it's going to get an upgrade to have that single wire CAN chip on it. So we're introducing a single board Arduino Due, but it's an EVTV Due with a different USB port, a CAN port, an EEPROM chip, and a way to connect to 12 volts. It's a little more secure. And that'll let us do essentially a single board controller. This is some software. Will go in the enclosure with the external port. And of course, the problem for us is that each one of them has to be made with different connectors for the different devices, but we're using a common box for it. In theory, if we sold a Chevy Volt charger and a DC to DC converter together, I could I've got the software where to run the two of them at the same time. You just have to have a special harness with both of them. That's in a theory. In practice, you probably don't want to do that because they're going to be in different places in the car. And so, you know, getting that harness the right length and so forth, we give you a little short harness. You can mount this close to the charger. You know what it is, and you can plug it in. The salvage stuff, and as I say, they often hack the cables into, and if they don't, you'll find it very difficult to get the connectors for them. We have a difficult time getting them, and we have a difficult time keeping them straight once we have them. I'm building kind of a wall of bins over there with different connectors and pins, but it drives me crazy. And so I think it's important that we be able to do this using the existing connectors. So down the road, if you have to replace it with another one from the dealer or from salvage that has the connectors that come on it, that it be able to plug right into your car in place of the old one. And so that's where we're going. So I've built a test bench here to do stuff. I can measure current and temperature. I'm right now testing this Chevy Volt. I've put in 385 volts, made some adjustments in the software, and it's at 384.5, just under, and the current's coming down, and it's holding that just below 385, and that's what I have entered with the laptop. Again, the process is going to be very simple. You do have to be able to work a terminal program through a USB port, but you plug in to this ASCII terminal, and it simply gives you a line of text. There's a menu in there. 90% of it is nothing you'd ever want to fool with. In the case of a charger, you want to set the voltage. You might want to change the current, but probably not. You might want to change the ending current, but probably not. It's really about setting the voltage to what you want it to charge for your pack. And you can do anything from 200 to about 420 volts we've tested. In theory, 511, but I haven't actually run one at that high level. Mark says 420 is about as high as it goes. I don't know what he was testing on to get that. It'll take a command up to 511 volts. And so this is where we're going to test the things and develop software and build. When we build these, we're going to actually test each one before we send them out and make sure that it works, at least on the bench, and then put that with the charger received from the dealer new. And so because we're buying them new, I'm not going to test the chargers. We'll have a warranty on them anyway from the dealer. So it's really just important that we test and make sure that our little controller is doing what it should. And we'll use this bench to develop that sort of thing. And so we've got four peripherals now that we're kind of handling. The Delphi DC to DC, the Chevy Volt DC to DC, the Eberspacher, which we will have available on the website as soon as I actually learn to pronounce it, and then the Chevy Volt charger that we've already sold 10 or 12 of. So I've got my little laptop on a cart. I've got a little heat exchanger cart here. And then this is a test bench. These are going to be permanently here. And so around the UQM power phase bench, we really are gradually getting almost all the parts of an electric car. And that's occasionally important. I kind of always wanted that because we have people come in here kind of from way left field and want to know what's in an electric car and what you do. And it's kind of an issue to explain to them the five basic parts: your battery pack, your charger, your DC to DC converter, your inverter, and your motor. And here's an example of a heating element. And we, of course, have a small air conditioner compressor that we offer as well. And those are kind of environmental issues that get you off into another world of kind of what I call piece parts, like Damien's power steering pump, or this heater, or an air conditioning compressor. Not all electric cars have those things or have them that way. But they all have a DC to DC converter. They all have a charger, an inverter, and a motor, and a battery pack. And I have all this here, or when we have students and people come in, I can kind of just walk them around right here in this local area and show them what those things look like. So it's kind of a display bench as well. So in doing the bench and in playing a little bit with the Eberspacher and the Volt some more, that's kind of where I spent my week and why we haven't done anything on a car. I'm driving the VW thing and enjoying it, but I want to make modifications to that. And of course, we still have the green VW thing. I've got a couple of people coming in over the next few months. We're being fairly selective. I've kind of taken it as an opportunity with the loss of Brian and Jesse to take a look at what kind of people we need truly to go forward as an organization into the future. And I'm not sure that things don't always pretty much work out for the best. It may be that we're going into a little bit different phase and a more technical one, and that some new blood may be actually quite in order. As you know, we did hire Colin Kidder as kind of our chief architect on the software side, and he and Damien are kind of beating each other to death over a distance of 4,000 miles and Chattabo. Mixed success, we get it charging, and then we go to another charger, and then we have to make a further adjustment. It was as feared. Each of the charge station implementers have introduced some interesting variants, and it's George Carlin effect, I guess, even among engineers. So that's what's going on. We continue to try to work out how to get PC boards done effectively in China. The costs there are just heroically less than here in the United States, but you do have quality issues. The biggest one is they try to replace parts with other parts so they make a little bit more on it, on the deal. And that's fine if they're working parts, but apparently there's getting to be a lot of bad ones. This EEPROM chip is wired incorrectly. It's installed in the right position. I've got 5 boards and 0 boards that have an EEPROM working. It's kind of got to be the chip. And, of course, conversations about that across that distance are always fun. They would love for somehow it to be my fault. But we've got a structure now where I'm just sort of interviewing board companies en masse, and anybody can bid, and I'll send anybody an order for 5 of them if they think they can do the board. But then if the boards don't work, they don't make the cut. But they're coming up with some interesting questions. So that's what I've been doing mostly this week, and why, again, there's very little to report about vehicles. But we had Jose Barriga and Damian McGuire, and they're doing some, Jose gave us an excellent walk around and showed what's happened to some of those better place packs, and I'm delighted to report. We had no idea what we were getting or what we were selling you. And ergo, the now in arrears, obviously, heroically low price, which Mr. Briga took advantage of and wound up with a low-cost bill. Turns out they were excellent battery cells. I really can't fault them. They're not a chemistry I'm familiar with. They're not my favorite. They're not built the way I would do it, but they're quite durable. Mark and I have grown to just love them as bench packs. We have a number of people now that have them in cars, and they just are working flawlessly, really. And so that was one where we got lucky. We've got a special now on a Siemens motor, DMOC controller, the JEVQ, and 100 of the SE cells. Now, guys, that's most of what you need for a car, and it's at $11,995. It's not most of what you need to get a car going. It's with a truly excellent AC motor and controller, and some of the best batteries we can find. They've been superseded by an upgrade of the chemistry. The CA series are better, but most of the cars we have around here are still on the SE series cells, and they just run like a champ. So that's not the issue. They're good batteries and make a great build. And you can be, you know, with the additional piece parts, if you can't build a car for $15,000 in parts, you're just not trying. It was interesting, that little car that Jose Barriga used, he spent $1,400 buying the car, and he's all in at $17,000. That's with a DC motor. I can see now the ability to do that with a much better Siemens setup, pretty much for the same price. My hope is, as the price comes down, that more of you are enabled to build your dream, a functioning, restored automobile that's magnetic drive. That's what you want, and that's what I want for you. And so it's unanimous. We just have to make it happen. Stay with us. And so that's kind of cleaning up, making a more official-looking test bench where I can develop, test, and build and test controllers for the various devices that we're making available. We've already sold 10 or 12 of those volt chargers and 5 or 6 of the volt DC to DC converters, a couple of the Delphis. And so that's the direction we're going to go. So I thought we might as well have a nice bench where I can have it all laid out and be able to hook up and test controllers. Somewhat complicated by the need for coolant. In any event, the big news this week is, of course, Tesla's announcement of the energy wall. Tesla's been playing with this for actually some time. They've sort of clandestinely gotten about 300 SolarCity customers and so forth hooked up with a battery, and 11 Walmarts, some Targets, and that sort of thing, and are playing around with storage for solar energy. I found Mr. Musk's presentation earnest and visionary, a little bit disingenuous, but basically we're with you, buddy. I like solar, and we do need storage for it to be viable. And I do like that he boldly strikes out into the claim that, hey, let's convert everything to solar. The battery pack, I like the pricing at $3,500 for a 10-kilowatt pack and $3,000 for a 7-kilowatt pack. A couple of problems there. It does not include, the fine print is there's no inverter included with the pack. That's just kind of the pack. But that's actually a lower price than what we sell Kalb cells for. And this is engineered with a battery management system and a cooling system and so forth, and a nice package. We'd probably be interested in the 100-kilowatt cabinet, which I understand will be $25,000, which would be fine. He glazed over kind of the thing with the grid, with the utility companies. I said about 4 years ago that at the moment where we begin to win against the oil companies and convert to a magnetic drive, a new monster will rear its head and we'll have to do a second battle, and that's with the utility companies. At the same time, there are some issues with the grid that are inescapable. I'm not too concerned about the utility companies. There's such monopolies and so government regulated and widely held stocks. Picture that they are going to misbehave, and when they do, we can fire them all. Simply take over the companies and fire all the miscreants. If we could do that, we still are left with the need for the grid. Now, what do I mean by that? As things shift, if you put solar on your roof and no longer need to pay a utility bill, but still want to be hooked up to the grid, they are already casting that as a free rider, which it's not. You're playing by the rules they set. However, they can also change them and make it where instead of the national average now is 12.12 cents per kilowatt hour, they could simply drop that to 5 cents per kilowatt hour, but have a $150 a month connection fee. And so they can do a lot of things to damage this solar situation, and some are starting to do so. So I see a big battle now with the utility companies. Already, our solar system here, I'm going to have to put in a second one to back up the first one with batteries, because the utility companies just basically wouldn't let us. They had it wired so that they can actually turn it off to keep electricity from coming into the grid when they're down, purportedly. But it really isn't. It never was the case. 10 years ago, we had switches powered by the grid that if you lost the grid, it would disconnect your building completely from the grid and had to be manually reset. So this is entirely a red herring, entirely made up. But they're playing it for all it's worth and kind of limiting and trying to control your use of your own solar plant. There are, of course, ways around it. So that battle is kind of out there. 7 kilowatt hours or 10 kilowatt hours of storage, these are for continuous duty at 2 kilowatts, is a little small. I don't think you're going to be happy in any large home at those power levels. The other thing I do like about the whole concept is that, of course, there's no place to get sufficient power to fast charge an electric car except for batteries. And so the batteries are kind of an issue. So this is all a good announcement. I don't think it's quite as earth-shaking as some would have you believe. I did kind of take exception to the blue dot, and let's take a look at why. Let's take a look at the blue dot and some of the ickies about what Elon is saying. For one thing, we have several cycles going on here. I put in a 15 kilowatt array at my home in Denver in 1998. And have kind of gone round and round with some of the realities of solar since then. And we are working with them here with a 25 kilowatt array that we put on the building here. Our grid, our national grid, if you did away with all the people and put people in that would do it just perfectly to suit you, you would find you still have a grid problem. This grid is organic. It has to be worked on every day. And that has to be paid for. somehow and in some way. Um, the usage of electricity is such that it is about half the level at 3 in the morning that it is at 3 in the afternoon. And this is a widely varying load with power plants that are not really well suited to varying loads. And they have to have a peak production capability, sort of by design, at least 10 and better 20% higher than the peak value that they'll reach in the year, which is typically at 3 o'clock in the afternoon in late July because of the air conditioning demand. But all your commercial and industrial electricity is used during the day. Your peak air conditioning, which is the 800-pound gorilla, you know, on the grid as far as load, happens not at night when you would think it would be for lighting, but during the day and primarily for air conditioning and the operation of businesses. and so you have this cycle that's a daily cycle. With regards to solar, you have some cycles as well. And that is, we get about half the power in January that we do in July. Largely not because it's hotter, but because the angle of incidence of the sunlight on the panel is more acute. And the length of the day is shorter. We have shorter periods of overhead sunlight. And so we get about half the power in January that we do in July. The government has a very interesting website called the Energy Information Administration, EIA. And you can get a lot of these figures from there. And from that point, with a pen and a napkin and a calculator, you can actually drive yourself crazy. In 2013, the latest year they had available, in the United States, we used 3,725,101,000,000 kilowatt hours in the course of that year. Mr. Musk claims 20 trillion kilowatts of energy annually. I'm not sure what he's referring to, but perhaps. In the U.S., at least, it's 3.7 trillion. I did some calculations based on our 180-watt panel. This is a very efficient cell at about 22%, and kind of a misleading for these calculations, as most of the panels being installed on rooftops are typically about 15.5% efficient, and they're much larger, and so and tend to be 300 watts. A piece these days, but with a much larger thing. Anyway, we're going to use our panels in a generous thing to basically, if the other panels aren't there yet, inevitably they will be soon. And we are talking about the future, so I think we can assume this fairly safely. Our 180-watt panels are 11.156 square feet. If you assume 4.5 hours of sunlight a day, which is about what we get here, certainly in the summer, that's 810 watt hours that we'll get out of those panels in the course of a day, or 72.6 watt hours per square foot, which is pretty good, actually. Let's see. If we use 3.7 trillion kilowatt hours in the course of a year, that works out to about 10,205,756,164 kilowatt hours daily. There are 27,878,400 square feet per square mile. And so, using our panels, just completely glued edge to edge, as far as you could see, that would be about 2,023,972 kilowatt hours per square mile per day that we could generate if we got 4.5. That means it would take, in order to do, using our panels, the 3.7 trillion used in the U.S., in a simple calculation, it's 5,042 square miles, and Elon Musk's blue dot is 71 miles on a side. Here's the problem. As I said, you have to be able to generate for the peak load at 3 in the afternoon rather than the nadir load at 3 in the a.m. To average this 5,042 square miles. You really have to have 7,500 square miles so you can generate enough electricity for the peak period of the day. And then you have your January, July thing. So if you're going to be able to do this in January, your 7,500 square miles looks more like 15,000 square miles, or half the size of Ireland. And so our blue dot is 122 miles on a side for 15,000 square miles. He did talk about putting that on the roofs. We can do that, pretty much so. We have 128 million residences served by electricity right now. If you put 10 kilowatt systems on average on all 128 million and figured you'd get 40 kilowatt per day in peak and summer, 20 kilowatt per day in winter, that would generate about 1.8 trillion kilowatt hours per year, 2.56 billion kilowatt hours per day in the winter, and 5.12 billion per day in the summer for 1.8 trillion of the 3.7 trillion we need. There's also 18 million, a little under, but 18 million, if it's not soon enough, it will be, commercial buildings. If you put an average of 100 kilowatt system on each of those buildings and got 450 kilowatt hours then on a 4.5 hour day, that'd be about 8.1 billion kilowatt hours per day, or just under 3 trillion kilowatt hours per week, giving us about 4.7 trillion kilowatt hours peak annually by putting a 10 kilowatt on every single residence in the country and 100 kilowatt on every single commercial building. Now, that's not entirely viable with a lot of restaurants, since if we couldn't bear 100 kilowatt package, but some factories could do more, and so hopefully we would average that out. So in order to generate enough electricity, solar, to meet the electricity that we already use in these buildings, we could just about do it if we had 100% participation. In other words, every single roof generated 10 kilowatts, had a 10 kilowatt plant on it, and every single business had a 100 kilowatt, we could just about do it. Let's talk about something else. About a third of our fossil fuel usage is to generate electricity. About a third is used to run our transportation. And if we get our way and change the third used for our transportation, the problem is we're going to double the amount of electricity required. And so in that event, simply the roofs and the of the businesses and the homes simply won't generate enough electricity to cover 100% of our needs. Now, there's a lot of things that can happen between reality and 100%. And of course, we have wind, and we have some nuclear, and we'll fall somewhat short of turning off magically all the natural gas plants that have been put up in the last 20 years. I think we could do some big damage to the amount of coal-fired electricity. But we kind of have to develop a national will to do this and to pay for it. It really doesn't work out. If you take it at the micro scale, and take Elon's Powerwall and use it to shift energy from morning to night or evening to afternoon to back up your power, to charge your car, whatever you want to do, it's just not going to quite work out economically. Similarly, how are we going to get 100% of the homes and 100% of the businesses to put solar on their roofs when it makes 100% of no sense at all economically compared to the cost of the electricity? Now, it would be a public good. The cost of the electricity is going up. The fossil fuels are problematical in a number of ways, and I think almost everybody pretty much clearly sees the future and shares Mr. Musk's view of it. I may be being generous there, but I believe that down deep, almost everybody likes the picture of natural energy from wind and solar and hydro. We're really sun-powered all along. The entire planet always has been. And to be able to take that natural light and convert it to the magical uses of electricity, I think almost everyone gets that that's a public good. When you get down to cases, it's how do I pay for it and why does that make sense? And I'll admit that the solar city program of basically leasing you the plant as if they were a utility company, an alternate grid, if you will, is a neat idea. And I agree with Mr. Musk that storage is a problem and that can be attacked, but pretty much has to be by battery. And so I'm on board. But how do you get there? And how do you get the rest of the population to get there too? And I'm kind of a believer in getting people to want to do things rather than forcing them to do things. Let's talk about our tax structure. I've talked to people here locally about this, several of them, who've gotten quite excited about the idea. And it's a pretty simple idea and fairly obvious to me, but it seems to strike a chord, and so I'll share it with you all. It's not terribly original, except in extent. We have a situation in this country where it's very difficult to employ people and increasingly attractive to employ machines. And part of it is the government's insistence that they be a third partner in the relationship between employers and employees. And in fact, that they enlist the employer to be their tax collection agent. And then direct how much he should pay them, how much he should pay them for overtime, how much he should contribute to their Medicare and Social Security, and then a whole series of laws based on how he discriminates against their sex and religion and race and age and so on and so forth. It's really gotten to be very uncomfortable to employ anybody. And anytime you can get a machine to do a person's job, It doesn't really matter what the machine costs because the government isn't a part of this little three-way. When you're dealing with a machine, it becomes automatically the choice at any price. And it's led to some problems that people are construing as being the rich against the poor or something. We've done this to ourselves. And it's been done sort of deliberately, but by people that just don't understand about the businesses, which they think are some sort of cornucopia treasure chest they can simply tap to meet their social desires for good intentions. Our tax system is largely based on the income tax. And I have to tell you that you'll be surprised to learn, since it's so unpopular in this country, that when it was introduced in 1911, it was probably the most popular tax program ever introduced. 90% of the population was agrarian. They lived on farms and had land. And the government at that time primarily taxed land and whiskey. And they did it in cash. You couldn't pay with land and you couldn't pay with whiskey. You had to pay with U.S. dollars. And their income would be quite variable based on weather and market conditions and pests and famines and feasts and so forth. And so many people lost their farms because they were unable to pay relatively small amounts of tax in cash, and they lost very valuable and a great deal of land. So we passed a tax on income, cash income, and started rolling back the taxes on land to the point now that agricultural land is taxed at as little as a hundredth of even residential property. It's really distorted the value of agricultural land at this point, another unintended consequence that has forced many, many people, families, off the land because the land became too valuable for them to farm. Kind of the same problem. And so we have this income tax. It's 104 years later. And now we have utter nonsense with 120 million people prancing around in April with this piece of paper, wandering from one H&R Block to the next, trying to get it filed with the government in time, usually to get money back that they have overpaid in taxes through payroll withholding. The compliance costs of this are simply staggering. The amount that companies spend to track these payrolls and collect this money and send it into the government and be audited on their income and so forth. And then all of these people having to pay accountants, in most cases, to prepare an income tax form that's so complicated that no one is certain that it's ever filled out correctly. And then it becomes an instrument of partisan politics, as the case of some of the Obama's administration singling out Tea Party groups for audits and special treatment. The whole thing's absurd, and it's kind of voluntary. You're basically, the enforcement is so minimal, they try to set an example of a few people by totally ruining their lives in the hope of frightening the rest of us into actually reporting our income and paying our taxes. That's all kind of a mess. In the meanwhile, our government has gotten to where they spend money like drunken sailors and hoes, and so we have this enormous deficit. And the big issue that nobody wants to come out on the street and face is the cost of the entitlement programs, is the euphemism for Social Security and Medicare, things that you and I have paid into for 40 years and are so entitled to a return on, as an increasing number of us retire each day, the government grows ever more precariously close to financial collapse. What's that got to do with solar? Well, let's just say I'm king for the day. And let's just talk about a fairly simple, easy to understand proposal that attacks a number of these problems at the same time. It's based on the concept that whatever you tax, you get less of. So why are we taxing income? So everyone gets less of it, which seems to be working out pretty well these days. And whatever you subsidize, you get more of. And so what I would propose, and you kind of have to make this worthwhile to the population to sell it, and that means make it illegal for states, cities, or anyone to require employers to collect anything, child support, United Way, get the employer out of the game of collecting money from their employees to send in. And do away with the payroll tax, not just the income tax, but yes, Social Security, Medicare, all of it. Whatever you get paid, you get to keep. And your employer has the minimal amount of paperwork, and whatever he agreed to pay you, he got to pay you. And let's get rid of all these accountants and compliance costs and filing of 120 million pieces of paper every year. And in the process, probably collecting about half of the taxes that we have on the books. So how do we fund the government? We tax energy, electricity, natural gas, coal, gasoline, oil, fossil fuels. We, by the way, exempt solar, wind, hydro, and anything that can be established as being a truly desirable, sustainable, non-French fry-related energy source. And this does a heroic number of things. Now, it would be, we're not talking about a little bit of a tax. We're talking about 50, 70 cents per kilowatt hour, $5 per gallon, $5 per cubic foot, a million cubic feet of natural gas. That sounds a little bit not progressive, but I think that, we could do this fairly easily. For example, the average U.S. home uses 970 kilowatt hours per year. We can just make a blanket, a threshold that you don't pay any tax on the first 900 kilowatts anywhere. Any meter gets up to 900 free of tax. The gas stations and the utility companies already collect taxes. It's a matter of software. If you look at your utility bill, you'll be shocked to learn that here in the state of Missouri, 10 to 12% of the total amount has nothing to do with the utilities. Their tax is added by the city, the state, the federal government. Everybody's got a finger in it, and the utility company collects from it. There's only 300 or 400 utility companies in the country. We could tax the gasoline at the refinery. We could tax the coal at the coal plant. We could tax the natural gas at the wellhead. Natural gas to the home, we have a meter on it already. Again, that would be through the utility company. And so this dramatically reduces the number of collection points from 120 million of them down to a few thousand, decimating the Internal Revenue Service, which I'm sure would be popular. But more importantly, it probably dramatically increases the compliance level. It would be easier to actually collect the taxes that we have passed and get closer to 100% of them and be collecting it from much fewer collection points, mostly points that already collect taxes. The rest of us would be relieved entirely of filing income statement or income tax, and relieved entirely from the compliance costs of that, and would actually get paid what we cost the employer. Instead of having this withholding where $90 or $100 or $200 of your money gets held back and sent to the government, you would get a full paycheck. You can afford $5 gasoline if you have your full paycheck back. And a lot simpler existence vis-a-vis the tax situation. The vast majority of homes would rather quickly figure out that just by turning out a few lights, they could be below the 900 kilowatt threshold or the 35,000 cubic feet natural gas threshold, which we could employ. And so it could easily be made very progressive. Kind of hard to escape for daddy warbucks or large companies because they simply use a lot of energy. Now, here's how you escape paying the tax at all. Install solar or wind or geothermal or water, hydro. And I think this would lead to a mass conversion to that. And the establishment of millions, I literally mean millions of jobs, not only because it's easier to employ people without having to deal with all that payroll nonsense, but because now a whole new generation of glass products for windows that was not economically feasible before becomes so. An entire new generation of air conditioning equipment, which the science and the technology, the engineering has been around for years, but it simply made no economic sense. All of a sudden, it does make economic sense because of the energy tax. Insulation, doors, windows, roofing materials, this goes across the gamut. LED lights, lighting systems, automated systems for the home to monitor energy usage and control it, where when you leave the room, it automatically shuts off the light. All of a sudden, a couple $100 for something like that makes excellent sense. New refrigeration systems, and of course, the installation of wind and solar on those 128 million homes. That's millions of jobs in the production of those materials and the installation on the roofs. Now, China may want to produce some of those panels, but it's going to be very difficult for them to take jobs away from people who are getting up on our roofs without them coming here. And then they become Americans and we don't care. And so, you know, I think this would be enormously stimulating and immediately set off a national rage for decreasing energy use that would become a pastime simply to get under the threshold and not have to pay the energy tax. Along the way, if that decreases the take for the federal government, and I think we would find that by collecting near 100% and reducing the collection points, that you'd be surprised what we could fund with a tax on energy. Of course, as we became more energy efficient, it might be possible and necessary to increase the rate of taxation on the legacy fossil fuels. But in the meanwhile, this would fund at the macro level, at the national level, a wholesale conversion to a much cleaner I think the benefits that fall out of this, I think we discover a lot of our health issues are coming right out of the tailpipe, and that a lot of our issues simply go away because of this conversion. So that's how to get there. The technology, batteries, yes, we need them, Elon, and it's good they're here. And solar and wind, but we have to have a national will to do it because at the moment it doesn't make sense, and simply subsidizing it with tax credits is sort of too little and too lame. We need to think about a total overhaul of our tax structure where we tax things we want to reduce, not things we want to increase. And so let's increase income and reduce reliance on fossil fuels. I find it interesting that the king of Saudi Arabia, now deceased, at the inauguration of one of the largest solar installations in the world, in Saudi Arabia, by the way, was the one to offer the note that we did not leave the Stone Age because of an insufficient number of stones. And we will not leave the oil age because of an insufficient amount of oil. There are good and plenty of reasons to go to the vision Mr. Musk paints quite ably. But it's going to take more than chanting and sloganism to get there. And I would advocate a very real and very central change of our national tax structure to do this. By the way, I think they should pay my Social Security and my Medicare, but that should be out of this tax. Let's get out of the entitlement game and fund it with gasoline and electricity taxes and so forth. And let's, right now, Americans are grossly wasteful of electricity. See this, by the way, in a Tesla Motors Club discussion, which makes no sense, because one guy's talking about his electricity usage here in the U.S., and the other guy's talking about his in Denmark or Finland or somewhere. They're using 2 kilowatts a day. We're using 30, and it's because it's simply too cheap. It's not worth your time to turn off a light in the bathroom when you leave the building. And so all over the country, we have not, it's actually gross waste of energy. And to make people conscious of that and to get them to do something about it is pretty simple. You simply have to make it more expensive. And I think by using a combination of thresholds and high per unit taxes, that you can get it where it's a choice of no tax at all this month or a very high one, depending on your behavior. And if you go up in status and economic capability and get a larger house than normal, there are ways that you can spend your way into reducing the tax as well by producing solar or wind energy, by making the home more efficient than normal. And this harnesses the entire population on the problem of the conservation of energy and the production of sustainable energy. And that's a public good. Meanwhile, funding our government somewhat more lavishly and perhaps allowing them to avoid this awkward moment where they have to come out and tell us that the person that we owe all the national debt to, 75% of it, of all the treasuries ever issued, are to the Social Security Administration. And we spent all the money. And who's going to go out front and tell people this? The Democrats would prefer it be the Republicans, and the Republicans would prefer it be the Democrats, and that's what the whole gridlock is about. Doesn't matter what they do about the budget or about taxes or anything else, The dirty little secret in Washington is Bernie Madoff was not alone, and who's going to go out front and tell people that their Social Security and Medicare system has been a pyramid scheme, and that the government has spent all the money, and the people we owe it to is ourselves, and that it's a Bernie Madoff moment. This would kind of let them segue that. Kind of come up with a whole new tax structure on energy, wipe out this one, and maybe nobody will notice that you're taking in more money and are able to deal with some of this debt and Social Security and Medicare and perhaps medical care for our veterans and some of the other things you should have been doing and taking care of anyway, by doing it entirely with not a step program, but a wholesale move from payroll taxes to point of sale and point of use taxes on energy. And I think we'd be able to collect more of our past tax money, less of it would be voluntary, we'd have greater compliance, much lower costs of compliance, and hidden taxes and costs to businesses, and perhaps a more friendly environment for companies to hire people instead of machines, while creating literally millions of new jobs that range from not very high tech, getting up on the roof and planting solar panels, to extremely high tech. How do we get those panels from 22% to 40%? And new materials, batteries, solar panels, wind machines, and so forth. And we have to be able to do that in a way that maintains our national grid, which is actually kind of in sorry shape in some ways now. And so it's a big solution for a bunch of scattered problems. But I think it's worth considering. Everybody I've run this by has been quite enthusiastic about it for some reason. I think it's a little obvious, but perhaps not. As George Carlin said, if you take the average intelligence of the average person in America, half the people you're going to meet today are not really that smart. Stay with us, and